Dr. Satya Balasubramaniam has provided insightful answers clarifying the intricacies between IVF and IUI. Now let's explore the differences between these procedures and understand how to choose the most suitable option.
So intrauterine insemination is a process where the egg and the sperm meet inside the body of the woman. The sperms are injected into the woman and they are supposed to find their way to the egg and fertilize the egg. So this happens inside the woman's body. In IVF, the egg and the sperm are brought outside the body and the fusion happens in the lab. And the embryo formed thereafter is replaced back into the woman's uterus. So this is the essential difference between IUI and IVF. For us to do an IUI, there should be a minimum number of motile sperms, preferably about 5 million motile sperms. The fallopian tubes have to be patent and a woman should have reasonable number of eggs.
Doctor, many couples struggle to choose between IVF and IUI. Could you elaborate on the factors that might influence the decision? Are there certain cases where IUI might be more effective and vice versa?
Generally, because IUI is a less expensive process and it's a simpler process, we tend to choose that as a first line of treatment, failing which we go for IVF. But there are cases where IUI cannot be done. For example, if the man's sperm counts are very low, or the woman's fallopian tubes are blocked, or woman has run out of eggs completely, then these are not candidates for IUI. They need to go for IVF. It doesn't work the other way. So somebody who has enough sperms to do an IUI can have an IVF too if the IUI fails. But somebody who doesn't have sperms at all, who for whom we have to take sperms from the testicle, or a woman who doesn't have eggs and has to borrow eggs from another donor, or a woman whose fallopian tubes are damaged irreversibly, these are couples who have to have IVF. They can't have an IUI.
Are there any potential risks or complications associated with both IUI and IVF that couples should be aware of when making their decision?
Yes, so it's important when we go for either IUI or IVF to know the limitations. In IUI, what happens is, as we said, we inject sperms into the uterus. The sperms don't know that the couple want to have one baby. If there are multiple eggs, there's a chance that many of these eggs may get fertilized. The woman might end up having multiple pregnancies, which is not a desirable end. While the eggs are being grown, the woman is having repeated ultrasound scans. If there are more than 4 or 5 follicles growing, we usually tend to abandon that cycle. And we also tell the couple not to have intercourse because there's always a chance of multiple pregnancy happening. In IVF, if we produce too many eggs, like 15, 20, 30, these can lead to a condition called ovarian hyperstimulation, where the ovaries are enlarged, painful, there may be fluid collection in the abdomen and around the lungs, which may potentially lead to major complications if not detected earlier enough. So there are means and ways to identify women who are at high risk of hyperstimulation and tailor their medications accordingly to minimize the risk of this happening to less than 1 in 100.
Emotional and psychological aspects are also crucial. How do the emotional challenges differ between IVF and IUI, and what kind of support system is available for the couples undergoing these treatments?
IUI being essentially close to normal is not associated with a very high level of psychological stress in couple. Also, the fact that it is less expensive makes it easier for them to cope with the negative result. IVF, on the other hand, is the final end stage treatment. The women and the husband, the couple in general, have invested a lot in terms of their emotion and health towards trying fertility treatment all these years. So the stress levels are pretty high, anxiety is high, and some are clinically depressed as well. Therefore, before starting any IVF treatment, all couples are evaluated by a clinical psychologist to make sure that they don't have these conditions. And if a woman is highly stressed or anxious, coping techniques are taught. Those who are clinically depressed are referred to a psychiatrist who will treat them with drugs. So there is a very important need to assess psychological disturbances in couples coming for fertility treatment.
Some couples might have concerns about multiple pregnancies during the fertility treatments. How does the risk of multiple pregnancies vary between IUI and IVF, and what measures are in place to manage the risk?
So as we discussed in our previous question, in an IUI cycle, if we have multiple follicles growing, so we would like to abandon the cycle to minimize the risk of multiple pregnancies because the number of pregnancies cannot be controlled in an IUI cycle. However, in an IVF cycle, we can create 10 embryos but transfer only one or two. That way, we can control the number of pregnancies. So if you put in two embryos, there's no way she'll have four babies inside. There is, however, a very rare chance that a single embryo may split and become identical twins. That is a rare condition, and if that happens, then the couple have to go through a process called fetal reduction to minimize the risk to the surviving baby.
What kind of pre-treatment evaluations do you conduct to determine whether a couple is more suitable for IUI or IVF? Are there specific medical tests or criteria that help in making this decision?
Absolutely. So for us to do an IUI, the man's sperm count and motile sperm count is a major deciding factor. If that is about 10 million, that's brilliant, but it should be at least above 5 million motile sperms. The second criteria is at least one of the fallopian tubes should be patent. There should be no blocks in at least one fallopian tube. The third is the woman should have at least some eggs for us to do an IUI. So these are the basic requirements for us to do an IUI cycle. For IVF, we need to check how many eggs are remaining in a woman's ovaries. So that is a predictor, pre-treatment predictor of success, which helps in counseling. We also need to know whether the couple have any infectious disease like HIV, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, syphilis, and so on, which might affect the baby. We need to know the semen parameters as well. Thyroid function of the female partner is particularly important, as are her blood sugars and also her hemoglobin levels. So these are some routine blood tests that are done for both fertility, IUI and IVF cases. But the most important difference between the two is the number of motile sperms and the patency of tubes, which are criteria for IUI.
That's a very important insight for all of us who are here. Can you share some patient testimonials or stories of couples who have successfully conceived through either IVF or IUI? Hearing about real-life experiences might provide reassurance to those considering these treatments.
Sure, I'd love to share. One is a 43-year-old woman who came for IVF. At 43, success rates with IVF also are rather dismal. And we had counseled her regarding the same. We'd also given her an option of going for a donor egg program, which she refused. She could collect only 3 or 4 eggs, of which there was one embryo, which was a grade B embryo. So our hopes were even further lowered by this, but she was highly motivated and wanted to have that embryos replaced. And she went on to have a single healthy baby at term. I think what even we as clinicians learned from this is perseverance in the face of all negativities. So even though the doctor is painting a not so rosy picture, if the woman and the couple in general are highly motivated, they may be able to achieve their goals. The second story that comes to my mind right now for a girl with a condition called Turner syndrome, where at a very young age, she got depleted of all her eggs and therefore would never have been able to conceive on her own. So post her marriage, we explained the condition to both husband and wife. Fortunately, the husband was cooperative. He understood that her uterus could be prepared for a pregnancy with hormones, but she wouldn't have eggs on her own. And they went in for a donor egg program and went on to have a baby. The other condition that with male factor that comes to my mind is a man who had no sperms and he had to take injections because he had a very rare condition called hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism, where there are no sperms in the semen. But having taken injections for 6 to 8 months, we found some sperms in his semen, which we used for IVF, and he could father a child.
These beautiful stories of success could be yours, provided you have the same kind of perseverance, patience, and self-care. So lastly, doctor, what advice do you have for the couples who are currently weighing their options between IVF and IUI? Any aspects they should consider before making a decision?
Important decision is for you to understand the possibilities and limitations. Understand what is the right treatment in your particular case not what worked for your friend. So you may be a candidate for IVF. Your friend might have conceived by an IUI, but don't insist on an IUI because that will result in a failure if you are not suitable for that. Secondly is be aware of the possible complications so that even if those complications rarely do occur, you're able to cope with it well with the help from the clinical team. Third is to understand every part of the fertility process that you're going in. Try to read up more about what is the current evidence and literature. Everything now is available on internet, especially in scientific websites. So you can go to websites like PubMed, which are medical literature websites. That will give you the latest evidence on treatment. So you are assured that when your doctor is suggesting a treatment, it is evidence-based. Finally, choosing the right hospital and the right doctor based on reviews and other patient testimonials will help you to choose a place where the probability of your going back with a healthy baby is maximized.
Dr. Satya, I want to express my deepest gratitude for sharing your expertise and knowledge on such important and sensitive topics. Your knowledge has undoubtedly been enlightening for our viewers, providing them with some clarity and understanding. Thank you so much for your time and for being so generous with your expertise. We truly appreciate it.
Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity.